doing.
It's symbolic and means stuff. Hello and welcome back to another Midnight Showing. As always, I'm Kelly.
I'm DJ.
And we just got a ghost in the shell. Probably the best anime adaptation we have ever seen.
That's actually not saying much.
Unfortunately, it really is not. But let's be fair. Before we probably will be tearing this movie apart quite a bit. Before we say any of that.
You'll be doing it much. Okay.
This movie was good. Let's just start that off right now. Don't believe the 50%. It's not that bad.
Yeah, 50% on Rotten Tomatoes, 6.9 on IMDb.
Yeah, it's if you can't tell, I'm a bit of a Ghost in the Shell fan. Thank you, Loot Anime, for giving this to me 2 days before this movie came out.
Yeah. I have little to no background when it comes to Ghost in the Shell. It's mostly clips I got from, this is the anime you should be watching. This is what we're comparing it to. The Matrix had references in it. That's basically,
Blade Runner is said to inspire the original manga, which you can definitely see. I have the original movie. I have it on DVD, and I also bought the new Steelbook Blu-ray edition that came out at Target, because Steelbook. Because
this movie was coming out, and they needed to, you know, raise a stink about it. As if they didn't need that to inspire this. This is one of the most influential anime stories, anime manga, just 80s things in general. If you're a fan of anime, chances are you've either seen this,
or you've seen it parodied.
Yeah.
You've seen this parodied.
Or you've seen,
this is almost as parodied as freaking, God damn it. I lost my train of thought.
Evangelion?
Yes, Evangelion, thank you. It's almost as parodied as that. Although, before we start about talking about anything about this movie, I think we need to talk about the controversy. So let's bring back my wonderful, wonderful section.
The whitewashing.
This is about the whitewashing inside of this, in which I am so tired of hearing that fucking argument, because it doesn't even fucking apply to this movie at fucking all.
They're all supposed to be Japanese in Japan. Sure, in the future.
Yes, in the future. No,
can't get a more futuristic city than Japan to begin with.
Here's the thing. The major is the one person in anime that you could not actually apply the whitewashing argument to. Who's to say that she doesn't say, hey, you know, that Scarlett Johansson person, she's looking pretty. Can I have a body like hers? Her body is artificial. The whole point of it is that it's not supposed to matter what kind of person or gender or race she is. That's one of the themes of the original movie. Did you not watch the fucking thing? Guess what? Most of the people who were bringing this up didn't. They just heard, it's based on an anime? Does it have a Japanese person in the lead? No! Oh my god, whitewashing! For fuck's sake, watch the fucking anime first! Look, I'll admit, I've seen the first movie, the second movie, I remember watching Standalone Complex a long time ago, but I don't remember much shit from it, because, well, it's Standalone Complex. I didn't watch the movie off of that one. I haven't watched Arise, but I did watch the movie off of that one. I own that one. But, you know, in all of that, the one big theme about all of it is that their bodies are completely replaceable. Literally, they get their arms blown off and their legs blown off, and even sometimes their faces blown off.
Yeah.
Who's to say that they can't just make a new body or choose a different type? It's not the whole whitewashing thing has been a big issue for just coming up recently. And you know what? Fine. It is a bad thing when we, you know, purposely cast a white actor inside of something that's not, when there are so many other people available. You know what? That's fine. These people casted every other Asian actor they could think of in this fucking movie, and they left two roles! Two! roles that were technically supposed to be Japanese to white actors because A, they looked the part, and B, they had star power.
Yeah.
They look like the characters. The person who plays Bato, who's amazing, and Scarlett Johansson, who does look like the Major.
She does. It's quite amazing, actually.
Yeah, and you know what? She was fine in the role, and all those fucktards who are bringing up this whitewashing bullshit need to actually watch the movie first. Maybe actually watch the original anime first, too, so you can get an idea of whether or not this character is supposed to be played by a Japanese person. And, you know, they actually did a survey in Japan just asking people on the streets, and they couldn't give two shits. They thought she looked great. You know, she looks like an anime character, and she fights like one, so... So yeah, that's my thought on that whole controversy thing that we have to bring up, because if we don't, someone's going to bring it up in the comments and goes, you didn't get it, you don't get it. No, you guys don't fucking get it. I don't like that argument. Yes, it was technically whitewashing with Tilda Swinton inside of Doctor Strange, which is the other big case right now. It was whitewashing, but it was whitewashing in order to not piss off one of the highest paying demographics. To which I still say that, yeah, you should have just cast a Tibetan man. You should have.
Oh, but it wouldn't have been as fun.
It would have been better. You would have gotten the character right. As good as a job Tilda Swinton did, you know, let's face it. A Tibetan man would have done a better job and fit the aesthetics everywhere a lot better. But, you know, that's neither here nor there. There, I at least understand the business side of why they did it. They just didn't want to piss people off, and now we have overreactive white guys saying,
Yeah, but they still made fun of having Tilda Swinton, a very small Celtic woman.
Yes. You could kick much ass.
So, yeah.
But, yeah, to this movie, the whole argument of whitewashing is a moot point. And it's frustrating that there's so many people who are going to boycott this movie because, A, they didn't watch the original anime, and, B, because they didn't watch this fucking movie, and they just assumed that it was all whitewashing.
They're not going to boycott this movie.
Yeah, there are people already boycotting it. There have been petitions online.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, because all whitewashing is bad. Now, let me cast this my little two-year-old inside of this play as an Asian tree. Look. I think that we should probably actually start talking about the movie, but we needed to bring that up because, you know, heaven forbid that we just watch a movie. So, yeah, let's actually start talking about the movie proper with... Oh, boy. You know, this is probably the best anime adaptation Hollywood has produced. But if there's one thing that this movie got fucking perfect, it was the visuals. This looks like the world of Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah.
This looks like Blade Runner on crack. This looks perfect. Everyone acts it perfect inside of this. It is, the whole world is just so vibrant. I kind of wish they did a different special effect for the thermal cam, and they never actually call it thermological camouflage, but, you know, it still worked. You got anything?
Everything looked really amazing. I don't know if we could actually live in a world like that, because there'd be too many distractions. I'm seriously just expecting someone to go to just crash into something else.
Yeah, there's no streetlights. It's all hologram letters on the ground. Seems a little weird.
Yeah. I know we can have the same argument for billboards, especially up and around Vegas.
Yeah.
Or huge cities like that. But these would cause huge distractions. Jesus Christ. It looked amazing, though.
Yes.
And it looked like it was taken, like, everything... I should probably save that for the bad. It looked great.
Yeah. They did a lot of real good anime recreations. Scenes straight from the anime. You know, Major ripping off, open the trank, which in the anime she actually isn't able to do. And she tears herself apart trying that, but it didn't work. I was really, really disappointed that Bato didn't show up with his freaking massive rifle and just start blasting the shit out of it. Because that is one of the best parts of the original movie. Bato just shows up, and he's got that basically a cannon the size of the one that Gamora's carrying in the Guardians of the Galaxy trailers. Instead of being a machine gun, it's just this massive round that big, and the thing is bam, damn, just taking holes out of this fucking tank. You know, I was hoping that was going to be there, but it wasn't. But in this one, you know, she actually does tear herself apart to rip open the door, and they did it very, very well.
Yeah.
You know, they had a lot of scenes like that. Like, the plane that was flying by when they did the upper shot, that's ripped straight from that sequence I was telling you about, where she's just on her walkabout that has nothing to do with anything.
Yeah.
And I know it has something to do with something inside of the actual anime. It was pandering, and it was time-wasting, but it did have a point. Don't yell at me in the comments. It's just that I have... Okay, full disclosure. Full disclosure about the Ghost in the Shell franchise. Everyone praises it as, you know, everyone, you have to watch it. It's symbolic and means something. Yeah, it's
what
symbolic.
They said about The Matrix, too.
Yeah, it's a good... The original movie is really good. I actually like the second movie better, and I know that a lot of people did not. You know, the second movie, it felt like all their prodding and talking about things actually, you know, tied into the story that they were doing, versus the first one that felt a lot like they didn't know what to do for a little while. Granted, this movie does not have that problem. This one, everything they bring up and talk about actually is examining the plot of the movie, which is great, especially when they're recreating scenes from the second one, which I like a lot more, as I said, like with the geisha dolls, or, what was the other scene? The Basset Hounds. Thank you for bringing back the Basset Hounds. It's a running joke inside of the anime. The original manga artist loves them, and he puts them everywhere. And he gave Bato one inside of the second movie that is so goddamn cute. And in this movie, they gave it another one that is pretty close.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. There's so many little recreations like that that are just spot on. And you're just like, thank you. You know, it's not the same exact situation as the show or the movies, but it works. It works in the context of this movie, and I really did love it. Kind of wish you didn't hit the slow-mo button every time you did one, but you know what?
Matrix did it. We can do it better.
Yes, they literally do hit the slow-mo button every single time they do one of those recreations, whether it be, you know, the major beating up the guy in the water.
They want you to soak it in and say, I remember that from the anime.
Mm-hmm.
This is how it's supposed to look in real life.
And to be fair, you know, the graphics with it did make it look fucking amazing at times.
Yeah.
So the slow-mo was called for. It's just the other times you're just like, okay, slow-mo, yes, I remember this. Can we speed it up a bit?
Yeah, the CG in this is really good. The scene where they go into the bar.
Mm-hmm.
You can see there's this guy whose entire bottom jaw is completely robotic, and his voice comes out, and it has this robotic tinge to it.
Yeah.
Those things combine, the sound design and the CG, is really good in this.
Although that guy didn't have CG.
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy was actually a practical effect, but his partner, who had, like, the CG arm, yeah, no, he was CG. No, everything about that just looks right, but going back to the sound, not just the sound design was spot-on perfect, this movie, the fucking music, you know, Kenji Kawai's, you know, legendary piece he did for the first one, they play in the end credits, but you can kind of hear shades of that going throughout the rest of the music. But it was still its own thing, giving you this kind of, I don't know, dreamlike feel at times. It was chilling. I want this album.
Yeah.
I really do.
Yeah. We saw this in 3D because it was the
earlier showing.
Yeah. And I have to wake up in the morning.
Yeah, the 3D, 3D wasn't bad. I actually thought it added...
When she does the deep dive into the geisha bot...
Yes.
The 3D was really good in that. I think that's where it showed most.
Mm-hmm. The other thing I wanted to bring up about the dive, that's a much more visual dive than I think the series had up until Arise. Usually when they dive, it's more of, you know, suddenly everything stops. and you just hear their voices talking. Which, yeah, they actually did apply that from the anime, where they did have the internal mind comms so that they couldn't be hacked or listened to. Unless you're trying to get a business guy to come send assassins after you.
Yeah.
I thought that was funny. I called that one, too. But it was, they do the mind dive, and they try to apply the visual from when they're actually looking at just the data screens. Because there's a lot of just, you know, shiny data porn, matrix, you know, information scrolls inside the original series. They tried to apply that to when they're actually looking at the data. So, like, when they're doing the little, whatchamacallit, the x-ray of the hotel, you know, they actually show, like, the data of the people, and they put the CGI over the actual people, or pictures of the people, so they could get it. And I thought that was, it looks so much better than even what they did inside of the original series most of the time. You know, later as technology kind of caught up with itself, it did fit. Also, did you notice that they didn't use Wi-Fi very much in this movie? You would think that would be kind of a bad thing, but that's actually from the anime, the original movie. They had no concept of what Wi-Fi was in 1995. So everything is wired. They have to plug in manually to everything except for wireless comms. And this movie kept that, and I was just like, thank you. That is a very, very nice nod to the original series that most people are not going to get. Oh my gosh. But it's... Honestly, the only other thing to talk about is maybe the actors' performances, which everyone took this 100% seriously. Thank fucking God. You know, we didn't get Elizabeth, whatever her name is, from Power Rangers, doing Rita, where she's just having the time of her life. You know, don't get me wrong, that did work in that movie, but...
Yeah, because it's a silly movie about a silly concept.
But then think about all the other adaptations where you just have one person who just seems like they don't even give a shit. Everyone in this one gave a shit. They wanted this to work, and when they need to be serious, they are serious. When they're throwing around their very snide, sarcastic insults at each other... Thank you. Everyone feels like a real person. And especially Scarlett Johansson. Let's just talk about her for a second. Her specific... She brought a lot of emotion to a very emotionless character, in my opinion. I know people are not going to agree with that. Again, I can't remember much from the standalone complex. And I never watched Arise, the series anyway. I did watch the movie. And even in that, her character is basically stoic and angry. In everything I've seen, it's just stoic and angry.
That's what strong female characters are.
Well, yeah. Well, give us some more range. And Scarlett Johansson gives us a lot more range inside of this. You know, when she's legitimately confused, she is legitimately confused. When she doesn't know what's real and what's fake anymore, you know, she still gives us the stoic and angry. I mean, there are scenes inside of here where I just like, is she gonna murder her? She's gonna kill her. She's gonna fucking brutally kill her. You know, there are a lot of scenes like that. But we get a lot more emotion from her, especially during the scene that they recreated almost verbatim from the original anime movie, which is the boat scene, where she comes out of the water, she's diving into the water and says, you know, she does that because it's the only thing that makes her feel real. Inside of the original movie, it always came across more that, you know, when she's describing that scene, is that, you know, there's nothing that matters anymore. It's just so pointless. Here, she's doing it because she doesn't know if she's a real person anymore. When she says that she feels the fear down there, and it makes her feel real, you know, it actually does look like it's the only tie to reality that she has left, and she's trying to hold on to it. Also, I don't know why they made Bato fish in the movie. Inside of the original one, he's just there to make sure that none of her gear breaks down and she sinks to the bottom of the water. She had a lot more than just flippers on in the original anime. In that one, she's actually got like a full apparatus and whatnot, and they do that whole reflection thing and like hold on to it with the music going.
I'm surprised they didn't recreate that.
I think it wouldn't have matched the tone of what the where the scene was in this movie. I think that's why they just did it, you know, slowly, as speedily as possible, but as slowly as possible, so you can know, remember this is a scene in the anime. It really does say something that Scarlett Johansson was able to bring so much humanity to a role that was all about questioning whether or not she's human anymore. I like that. I really did. Honestly, there's nothing else I got inside the kids section.
Yeah. I was just paying more attention to the effects because, like I said, I don't know much from the anime, save for a few scenes, like mostly the symbolism.
Yes.
It's symbolic. It means stuff.
Oh, my gosh. So many people are going to hate me for saying that.
Oh, no, they're going to agree. The critic will probably agree with you. Because those are the things that The Matrix brought in.
Yeah.
Was, are we human at this point, or are we just constructs?
And that was actually ripping off from a comic book that was ripping off from Ghost in the Shell.
There you go.
So
a ripoff of a ripoff.
A ripoff of a ripoff. And
well, I don't know whatever it was ripping off, but the ripoff was ripping off Ghost in the Shell.
I can't remember the name of it, but they said, but there's like behind the scenes stuff where apparently the Wachowskis were actually handing out the comic and to give the people, the actors, and the idea of how they should be playing the role. So they knew about it.
Yeah.
The sequels have nothing to do with the comic, and that's why they got more into it. But, you know, this one, yeah, honestly, the visuals are great. The acting's great. Unfortunately,
yeah. Thing I wanted to say was when it does slow down to basically say this is something from the anime that you should recognize, that's what I kept thinking. Now, like I said, I didn't really see the anime. I didn't really grow up with it. It was never a major part of my life like most anime nerds out there. But I could tell. I'm like, I wonder if this is something from the anime. I'll ask Kelly in the car.
Yeah. Yeah. Every single time I hit the slow-mo button. And, you know, again, it felt appropriate a couple of times. A few times, it just felt, why the hell are you hitting slow-mo here? We don't need the slow-mo. Stop hitting the goddamn slow-mo button. And it happens a lot. And I don't want to make the, of course, it's an adaptation of Ghost in the Shell. And it's taking from basically all of the series, except for maybe Arise and its movie, which still ripped off a few things from the original parts, but yeah. Inside of this one, I mean, there's so many references to Ghost in the Shell Innocence and the original Ghost in the Shell movie that, you know, hitting the goddamn slow-mo button for every single one. I swear, if you sped up all those scenes to normal speed, you cut 20 minutes off this movie. And again, sometimes it was appropriate, like some of the action scenes. But other times, she's just swimming. She's swimming in the water. Why did you hit the fucking slow-mo button? And then the other part, there's no real, you know, gripping action scene in this movie. As I was saying, I was describing the whole tank thing inside of the original one. And it was actually, in the original, that whole tank fight was this big battle of tactics. She knows that she doesn't have anything that can take this down. Her only hope is to get on top of it. So she's purposely using all of her ammo to try to get it to use all of its ammo. And the second that it she assumes that it's out of ammo, or at least one of the guns are taken down, she rips off everything, turns on her thermocam, and jumps on the goddamn thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's a battle of tactics and wits of trying to outsmart this spider tank that's protecting the Puppet Master, well, the Puppet Master corpse, so that Section 6 can destroy it. Inside of here, it's just a straight-up tank battle in the dark with no real theme or variation until the end where she rips it off. But again, that's just a rip-off of another scene where you hit the goddamn slow-mo button again. You know, there's no real wow factor to this. This is why I kind of wish that they had gone with it and Bato shows up with his big ass fucking cannon.
Yeah.
Because that would have been the moment where it's like, holy shit. You know, it would have given us a moment there where we could really, really engage inside of this heavy duty. But we never got that.
Yeah.
It never happens. And
the villain for me, like the main villain,
Mr. Cutter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a guy in a suit.
He's a guy in a suit in a cliche action film that we've seen 1,000 times before. Hell, even this idea of him having to destroy the product of his creation so he doesn't go to fucking jail.
Yeah.
Again, we've seen that before.
He did next to nothing outside of shooting the scientist that worked on her.
Yeah, which is another scene they wrote from the anime.
He didn't
Slow-mo!
Yeah, he didn't go crazy at anything. Heck, in the beginning, when we were introduced to Hideo, I thought he was...
Kuze.
Yeah, Kuze.
Hideo is a spoiler. But Kuze, yeah, I mean, he was much more active villain.
He brought up Ultron vibes for me.
Well, not just Ultron
When his voice was, like, glitching out, and his prosthetic, and his mechanics were kind of like, yeah.
Yeah, they were misshapen, they didn't feel like they fit, half of his skin is gone. You know, he was a much better villain, and I think that maybe you should have kept him as a villain, but you were trying to make him more sympathetic and basically give him the same story as the Puppet Master from the original one, where he's just trying to basically fuck with her on a program level to create a new life form that is neither AI nor human.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's basically what happens inside the original movie, too. Spoilers for that, and... Well, fuck. How am I supposed to talk about this without spoiling the original movie? But it
was made in the 80s. It's been over 30 years.
95.
It's been 20 years.
Yeah.
It's been over 20 years.
And let's just also get this out of the way. This is heavily dumbed down from the original series. Now, don't get me wrong. The original series dumbed itself down after the first two movies. The first movie... Again, I never really felt for it because it felt like it was just spinning its wheels at times. The second movie I liked a lot more because everything they brought up had something to do with what was actually happening.
Yeah.
This one, everything they brought up does have something to do with what's happening, but it is heavily dumbed down. So heavily that it almost doesn't really ring as true. It just feels like sycophantic posturing, I guess would be the best way to say it. It's there. There are all these ideas about identity and whether or not you're human anymore if you've removed every single part of your body and replaced it with machines. You know, there are some very heavy-duty questions in here, but again, they just feel so dumbed down that it feels like you're watching a bad Star Trek episode sometimes. a bad Star Trek episode in Blade Runner.
Wow.
I wanted it to be more intellectual, but I wanted it to be more intellectual like Ghost in the Shell 2 Innocence, where, you know, everything they brought up actually did mean something for the story. And, frankly speaking, I would have loved to see an army of robotic dolls, you know, on a ship against Bato, where one of them just happens to get hacked by the Major, and the Major and Bato versus... everyone. I really wish that they had done something like that inside of this movie, but they never did. And sometimes it just felt pretentious sometimes. And frankly speaking, this film's biggest crime, it's forgettable. It really is. As good as it is, again, how many times have we brought up Blade Runner or The Matrix?
Too many.
This style has been used and it feels generic at this point.
Yeah.
This is the series that one of the series that basically, you know, mainstreamed-ified it. You know, this is one of those series that inspired all those other filmmakers that you've seen before to use this type of style. But we've seen this style done so many times.
Yep, The Matrix was I think The Matrix was the one that mainstreamed this kind of style for everybody. Ghost in the Shell, especially at the time it was made, wasn't really accessible, which is like probably 75% of the reason I never did.
Well, one of the reasons why Ghost in the Shell sticks out for a lot of people is that, you know, Siskel and Ebert actually went out of their way to make a show dedicated to Ghost in the Shell. They saw this movie and they said, holy shit, everyone should see this movie. And they went out of their way to spread the word. That's why we have a DVD release of it. It's because, you know, everyone did. I mean, hell, you could probably still find it on VHS. And those ones aren't actually that rare. You know, it's one of the first animes that did truly jump ship into America. And, you know, it only took you 22 years to bring it over to actually try to make an adaptation in Hollywood.
Yeah.
Good job.
And there were books about the influences and everything about the Matrix and like if you want to be like a computer programmer or everything.
Yeah.
Like this is how the makers of the Matrix designed all their things. If you want to design a movie or a film about this and books about its philosophies and everything, and basically the original artist got screwed.
Yeah.
Hard.
Yeah.
For all of this.
Well, they always do. I mean, there's always going to be ripoffs inside of this world.
Yeah, there's
it's just that
countless parodies, including Power Rangers, going back to that.
RPM.
No, not just that. It was Time Force that did it first. Because Time Force came out in 2000.
Oh, the Matrix gunfight scene.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that didn't really have any happen inside of this movie, though. He had some good gunfights. Just
couldn't help thinking that the Dragon Zord from the first series inspired Neo at some point.
No. Drawing connections where they aren't there. That's the original Ghost in the Shell movie's job. Sorry. That's the Ghost of the Movie standalone complex movie job. Sorry. That's from Sage's review. But it's just this movie is fighting an uphill battle against, you know, a lot of people. I thought this movie would have been sold out, truth be told. I really did. You know, it just didn't feel like it just feels forgettable. Feels like it's just gonna come and go, which is better than the anime adaptions we've gotten beforehand, you know. Dragon Ball.
Yeah.
Or Speed Racer.
Any of the actual live-action anime adaptations that have come out in Japan. Like
some of
Assassination
the
Classroom.
Oh, Assassination.
Or Death Note.
Death Note, the only thing about that didn't really work was the Ryuk and the other guy. But, you know, there's nothing inside of this one that couldn't be. This is probably the easiest one that you could apply to mainstream Hollywood. And
I think Rurouni Kenshin would work.
Oh, they did that. They got 3 movies out of Rurouni Kenshin, and they are great. Yeah. I still need to buy them. They're actually at Walmart right now.
Yeah.
But I don't have $60 to drop on that.
Some of the direction in Phoenix Wright didn't work, but I still kind of want to see it.
It's an interesting watch. It really is.
Yeah, Suede did a review of it a long time ago.
But yeah, I think that's basically all we had to say about Ghost in the Shell. We're tangifying really badly now.
Anime adaptations?
Yeah.
This is what it is.
Just anime adaptations in general. And frankly speaking, you know, as much as there are just bad things inside of this. I personally don't think this movie is bad. It is forgettable. But I still think that it's a step up from what we've gotten as far as anime adaptions go. It does have the questions inside of there. It does bring them up. And if you're willing to actually, you know, sit through the potentiality of some of them, you know, they might actually inspire you, might actually learn something. Hell, it might inspire you to go watch the original, which is a very, very good choice. If you haven't watched the original, you know, I'm not going to be that one person that's going to be like, if you don't see that movie, it's going to be a little bad for you. It's like, nah. It is really good, but the better is in the sequels. Ghost in the Shell Innocence is much better than the original, in my opinion. And if you watch both of those, because this movie got you curious, this movie was a plus.
Now,
it wins.
You are actually planning to see this again. Would you recommend it to pay for 3D? Again.
3D?
Yeah. Tonight they also
They kind of screwed up the projector tonight. I had to go tell them that it wasn't sized right with the screen.
Yeah. I was going to say, tonight they also have the big 3D IMAX showing.
Yeah.
So
IMAX, maybe. If you can get your hands on the IMAX, maybe. But full-on 3D, I don't know if I would say this was completely worth it. There were great scenes of 3D, but like when Cutter gets shot into the pool and the water splashes, that felt like 3D poop. It really did. So yeah, my personal take on this is that it's a see it, but you don't have to go out of your way with 3D. It's a see it. You know, don't worry about wasting your money on it. It's worth seeing it full price. It's just maybe not worth going to spend the extra for 3D.
Yeah.
IMAX, definitely.
3D. Yeah, like I said, the best time in 3D shown for me was in the deep dive. That was probably the best. And the scene where she's like kicking around the guy in the water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which was another scene that was lifted directly from the anime, which
notice
how much slow-mo was inside of that scene.
Yeah. When I was going on that tangent, that's the thing that kept in the back of my mind. But it was still cool.
Yeah. Feels a little Matrix-esque.
Yeah. I'd probably see it again. I probably wouldn't spend the money for 3D. I bought the tickets tonight.
Yeah.
Like, holy crap. Those are expensive. Between the popcorn and the candy and this, it was like $40. So.
But yeah, my final verdict is see it.
See it.
And yeah, I think that's it for us. Have you seen the new Ghost in the Shell? Did you watch any of the original series? Am I an idiot who just doesn't get the series? Please let me know. Also, subscribe to Loot Anime to get wonderful, wonderful apparel like this, which this is probably the best shirt I've got from them in a little while. And, like, holy shit, this is one of the most comfortable shirts I've had in a little while, too. So, go get on Loot Anime.
Hashtag not sponsored.
Hashtag not sponsored. yeah, tell us what you thought about all of the Ghost in the Shell stuff in the comments down below, and let's get some healthy discussion going. Please leave the whitewashing stuff out of the comments.
Please. You will be blocked.
I won't go that far, but I may respond very angrily. Just say that. Be sure to follow us on all of the social medias, the Facebooks, the Twitches, the Twitters, all that stuff. All the links are in the description down below. And, yeah. I'm Kelly.
DJ.
And we'll see you all
next time. are you doing?
It's symbolic and means stuff. God damn it.
Stupid truck! That was a good take, you stupid asshole!
That's gonna be at the end of the video right there. You stupid asshole! That was a good take!